Hey, it's Mark Podolsky, the Land Geek, with your favorite niche real estate website, thelandgeek.com. And on this week's Roundtable Podcast, we have almost all the usual suspects. We've got the Land Shark, Landon Harris. Landon, how are you?
I'm well, Mark. How are you?
So Scott just gave me a look like, is that really his nickname? Yeah, that's really his nickname.
No, that's not what we agreed on.
That's not what
the community.
That is not. Where is that?
No.
That was on Mighty Networks.
No. I agree with that. The aquatic investor was that thought.
AI, Landon AI. Come on, man.
An AI.
I've spoken. It is Land Shark. It makes a lot of sense.
It's got land, it's got water, it's got a sense of danger at boot camp.
I thought we had this conversation a while ago and the result was different. So
we did.
What
Mark's making this up. There's no poll on my networks.
No, there was.
Where is it?
Search for it.
Who ran it?
We ran it. We gave a bunch of names. The team.
You better allow Scott to share his screen. I'm sure he's
going this is going down in protest, man. It's got to.
Can I just finish the introduction and we can just let Landshark land and marinate on that for a bit? Because we've got his partner in crime putting in the reps, Teria Harris. Teria, how are you?
I'm well. How are you?
Good to see you.
We've
got the technician, Erik Peterson. Erik, how are things?
I'm good-ish.
You're good-ish? Is Elijah beating you-ish? In the father-son?
At the moment, yes, he is.
Wow. I still put my money on you long-term. We'll see. And then last but not least, you know him. You love him. Scott Todd from scotttodd.net. Landmodo.com. Learn anything about anything, investorninjas.com. Your flights go Sherpa. Scott Todd, how are you?
I'm good, Mark. And by the way, I found Gretchen's post. Okay, I found Gretchen's post on January 18th, and it's not a poll. It's not a poll. It's an open-ended question with no options like land and AI and whatever, aquatic investor. And then you're the first one that chimes in there that says, I like the Land Shark, but don't love it.
But the community has spoken.
But they haven't. There's no consistency here. One, look, aqua land. Yeah, Teria likes my suggestion. And by the way, Teria's vote counts for like 100. Why? Because she's got to put up. I mean, she lives with the Landon.
All right. Actually, you know what? Hold on a second. I'm
no poll.
Hold on, because I actually had somebody put in the chat to me a great one for Landon. I really liked it.
There's a new name.
A new name.
As if we need more options.
And by the way, this comes back to a tip of the week. I'm reading a book called Building a Second Brain. And if I don't write things down and don't have it in a good spot, I don't remember anything now. So let me see if I can find it. Is it in here? I'm doing a search. But anyways, I'll find it. We'll come back to it. Anyways, I digress. We're getting off on the whole Land Shark thing.
As we have in the past.
Isn't that our podcast until it's resolved?
It is not the podcast. We actually have a really good topic today.
Mark, you know how like when they nominate the next pope, they all go into the room and they don't leave it until the new pope is named?
Yeah.
I don't think we can, or the Speaker of the House, nothing gets done in the House of Representatives until there's a speaker. I don't think we can do anything until Landon gets his nickname.
Look, I'm out then.
Erik, roll with me on this one. We've made our arguments here until it's final. There's no podcast.
We have to unionize. We must unionize.
A All right, Mark, we can get on with today's show.
This is really devolving quickly. Here's our topic. It is an email that I received. I'm going to read it, and then we're going to discuss it. Hi, Mark. I've recently been looking around your website, bought and read your book, and have been seriously considering taking your courses. I kind of understand now how the land business works, but I have a question about the morality of buying something, land in this case, for pennies on the dollar, and then selling it for 300% or more return on investment. I am not able to shake off a feeling that that is morally incorrect. I know that we are buying from owners who probably want to just give away their land in many cases, but how can we justify the ethics, morality of selling the same land for so many times higher than its value? I'm unable to convince myself that this is a legally, for lack of a better term, and morally ethical business, though I am keenly interested in moving forward. Just wanted some thoughts, insight from you on this niche. This is what's been keeping me from scheduling a call with your team. I think it's a great subject to bring up. I think we've talked about this in the past. I remember at a boot camp once I brought this up. I'm like, who feels uncomfortable about making these margins? And I remember Mimi Schmidt like rose her hand. It's and like, all right, Mimi, let's talk about it. We had like a little therapy session, but she was definitely uncomfortable with it. So the land shark, Landon Harris.
So
what are your thoughts?
You know, I feel like I'm a pretty morally grounded person. Like that. Just
well, wait, now, wait way. A second. We'll it's, ask Teria about that for sure. She lives with you.
Like I do. Like I really feel, you know, strongly that I do think I try to do things right. So when I look at this, like I think of it a few different things. If I'm not breaking any laws. That's first. Like I've broken no law by selling you a property at 4x of what I purchased it for. I find that if I'm saying this is the value of something, and then you agree that that's what I want, I want to pay that. I don't mind paying you that. I don't see that's the difference. To me, it's like if I decide to sell you an old laptop for $100, you say, okay, I agree with that. But you go online and you see that same laptop. It's same year, same model, same everything. And you go online, you see it for $500. Well, and you decide you want to sell it. I can't be upset with you wanting to sell it. That's you saw it was priced at that. So for me, there's no morality that I'm breaking or even any law or anything else that I would consider that brings this to a point where I'm doing something wrong. I don't know. That's just kind of my two cents on that.
I like it. I like the logic of it, but I do want to ask Teria putting in the reps Harris. First of all, is Landon ethical and moral in your esteemed in your esteemed opinion because you live with him?
Esteemedly biased no, opinion. Landon is definitely a rule follower. He calls
me a rule follower all the time.
He's a rule follower. Let's break a few, please.
So, I almost, that's a funny thing because I almost feel like this is another topic along the lines of reclining. Like I'm a big rule follower. I am a big rule follower. If there's a sign that says, you know, don't do this or don't do that, like I typically will follow the sign. I have other people in my life that that's a suggestion. That's not a rule.
I look at it more as suggestions. Landon, it's a rule. Yeah.
Okay.
Law.
It is. It's law. So I guess I have two points. One is if you feel something is immoral, it may feel immoral to you and maybe you shouldn't do it. I'm not here to say what is or isn't moral, because that I think becomes a personal judgment. But if that person feels this is not, you know, moral, then maybe you shouldn't do it. I agree with Landon. We're not robbing the sellers of their land. We present an offer. And some of our sellers come back and they counter our offer, you know, because maybe they feel their land is worth a little bit more. Some accept our offer. It's an offer. We're not swindling them out of their land in no way. It's an agreement between us and the seller, as same as it is an agreement between us and our buyer. We establish what the land is worth when we enter into a contract with someone willing to pay that amount of money. So I don't personally feel it's moral, again, because I'm not doing anything unethical to obtain the land, and I'm doing nothing unethical to sell the land. We disclose our prices, how much it is. If you want to buy from me, here's the price.
I think that's a great point. It is just an offer. No seller is having their arm twisted. And she even brings up the point, like, yeah, I know you're helping the sellers out, but I'm just uncomfortable with the amount of profit I would personally be making.
Then maybe she buys the land and she only marks it up 10% and she sells it, right? No one says you have to mark it up 300x.
And that's so true. I mean, I remember being on a mastermind call, and Bob Demick was kind of embarrassed. He had done a deal and he didn't want to bring it up to the group because it only made 150%. And we're like, well, 150%, like, in what return in the world would someone be embarrassed by that? But like in our community, we kind of hold that standard of, you know, if you're going to sell, we think that there should be a 300% margin of safety, and your typical margin should be 300 to 1,000%, if not more, because of time value of money, etc. But I think the technician might have a different take on this. Erik, what do you think?
I think that you're not really understanding how this process works. They're not understanding the whole picture here. I mean, what we offer is essentially a service, okay? We're coming in as experts in the field of land, okay? And we're bringing our expertise to the table and we're saying, hey, if you want to sell this piece of land, I can pay you X. Okay. And maybe the seller agrees, maybe they don't, but assuming they agree and we buy it for $100 or whatever the price of that property is, and we turn around and we go market it and ultimately sell it for maybe 300 to 500 times that amount. Well, the only reason we're able to do that is because of our education, our knowledge, our understanding of the market, our tools in place, our systems, all this stuff that we built in order to go out and get that return. So don't forget that there's value to all of that stuff. In the same way that you go hire an attorney because they're an expert in the field and you have to, I don't know, go to court about whatever, like, you're going to pay them what they ask because they're the expert in the field. They know what they're doing. I look at my position in this company the same way. I mean, we're providing that service. And again, we're not twisting people's arms to sell these properties. We're simply making an offer. And I can tell you over and over from people that we've bought from, you know, stories of satisfaction. These people are not upset that they're selling to us. They are thrilled that they're able to get rid of this piece of land and not have to worry about it anymore, whether it's because of back taxes, whether it's because of they just don't want to deal with it. They don't have a purpose for it anymore. There's so many reasons. But ultimately, these people understand that we're in business and we're going to go out and profit on selling this property in the future. And something that the email said, it said, so many times more than it's selling the property, so many more times than its value. And I disagree with that because we're not selling the property for more than its value, right? Like the value is determined by whoever's selling the property and the buyer. So that's the value. We're not inflating the value. We are buying at a discount, but we're not inflating the value. We're not going out to the market and saying, well, you got to pay me however much more than the real value of this property.
Yeah, that's a really good point. You're not going to outsmart a market.
Yeah.
The market's going to only buy what it thinks it's worth.
Right. And the other piece that I didn't really touch on is like, not only are we bringing a service of being able to liquidate this property on the other side, you know, from a retail standpoint, but we're also taking that asset and we're making it affordable for nearly anybody that wants to own this piece of property. So again, like, yes, in the long term, we may have a profit of 300 to 500% on a given property, but that's not necessarily going to happen immediately on the sale. We might collect $100 down in a 250 doc fee and then $100 a month for the next 72 months. Well, you know, we have to factor that into our business and our profit margins, right? Because we're not getting our money up front. But doing that allows us to reach such a broader audience than we can otherwise.
Yeah. It's a really good point. And you've all made really good points, which is why I love that Scott Todd has to go last and try to find a unique point of all the points that have been brought up. But actually, Scott, I actually have some thoughts on this as well. So you're not really going last.
Okay. Hey, I can't chat this. I was going to chat something for you to read, and I can't do it because the Zoom setting, but no problem. Listen.
First of all, I don't know why that is, because it does allow participants to chat. Now try it again. So
okay.
Weird.
Yeah. You might want to read this, Mark, just so everybody, because you're the rule follower. You might want to read this because this is important. This is a rule. It's an official rule as I found it. I'll just go ahead and read it to you. Okay. Like, it says that it's hereby established and acknowledged that per the rules and regulations set forth, the individual known as Landon shall hereafter be referred to and identified as Landon AI. And it keeps going on, but this is the rule. So if you're the rule follower, follow him. And I've made a shortcut for you too. Like, the rule is Landon's nickname is Landon AI. All right, so that now.
Okay, another question. You know, while we go off the tangent of Landon AI, I do think Landon C is pretty good.
Landon
okay. C.
Now let's get back to the topic at hand. Okay, look, anybody can do, like, anybody can go check me on this one, but I'm using this to make a point. Like, I think in the camera, if you're watching this on YouTube, I think I can make this. Maybe I can't. I don't know. Let me cover up my head or something. Anyway, this is a golf club. And the name on this golf club is Adams, the manufacturer. Adams, Tight Lies, Strong 7. You can see it really good right here, I think. Yeah, Strong 7. Okay. And if you just plug this into, like, eBay, this thing that says Adams Tight Lie, Strong 7, you'll see that the price of this thing ranges from, this golf club ranges from $15 to, one person I saw was selling it just now for $50 plus $15 shipping and handling. Okay. So anywhere from $15 to, let's say, $50 is the price of this golf club. The general market can't decide what the price of this golf club is. They can't do it. Now, me, I didn't go on eBay to buy this thing. I wanted to buy it. I heard about it. So I'm like, you know what? Let me go see if I can hunt around. So I went to this place called a thrift store. Okay. The thrift store was selling this same thing for $3. $3. Now, I knew when I walked into the thrift store that eBay was selling this thing for $15 to $50. So is it my obligation, by being a moral person, to walk up to the seller, the thrift store, and say, hey, you've got this thing priced wrong? You have a price for $3, but the price on eBay, which is a really good market for pricing, is anywhere from $15 to $50. So I'm going to pay you the $3, but I'm stealing it from you. No, it's not my obligation to set their prices. Now, if I saw that the price didn't look right or something like that, but all the golf clubs there were $3. Now, I want you to think about this for a second. I bought this golf club for $3. I can turn around and sell it on eBay for $15 to $50. Did I steal this from anybody? No. The seller set the price that they thought was fair. Okay. Am I twisting someone's arm to buy it from me for $15 to $50? No, because the person buying this golf club from me will buy it at the price that they think is fair. See, it's all about what people, two parties, think is a fair price. It's not, there's no magic there. It comes down to basically a mutual agreement of what the fair price is. Now, what about the thrift store that got this thing for free? They didn't have to do anything to sell this thing to me, right? Like, they didn't have to go buy this thing. Someone gave this to them for free, and yet they sold it to me for $3. Think about their margin. Their margin is ridiculous. Should they have told the person, hey, we're going to sell this thing for $3, so at least we have to pay you like $2.50 or $2. No, there's no obligation there. Why did the person get rid of it to the thrift store? Because they were done with it. They didn't see the value of it. Now, does the thrift store owe an obligation to the person who's donating us to say, hey, you're kind of giving us this thing, but we can go on you could go on eBay and sell this thing for like $50. What do you mean it's no value? See, we all value things differently. We all value things at different prices. The person who gave this thing up didn't value it. They were done with it. They thought there was zero value in there. The thrift store, they valued it $3. Why? Because they paid nothing for it. But yet some items they sell in there for $20, $30. They didn't pay anything for that. They're not selling everything. They're making huge margins, that thrift store is. But the people on eBay, there's people on eBay that are going thrift store hunting for these things, buying them for $3 and selling them for up to $50. Do they have an obligation to tell anybody, like, oh, well, I only paid $3 for this thing, so I'm only going to sell it to you for $4. No, it's called capitalism. That's the way that it works. And, you know, Erik brings out some good points. Landon and Teria bring out some good points. But every time I hear this, I think about this golf club and the perceived value of multiple people in the stream of commerce. That's it.
You know, I'm so glad you brought up capitalism, because there's that famous Winston Churchill quote. It has been said that democracy is the worst form of government, except all the others that have been tried. And the same could be said for capitalism. So really the question is, are you uncomfortable living in a capitalistic society? And getting back to Teria's point, you don't have to be a capitalist. You can certainly, if you feel that it's morally and ethically wrong to live in a capitalist society, then there's other ways to live. Now, the question is, you probably wouldn't want to be in those countries, because as capitalism has so many flaws, it's still the best of the systems out there. And we've seen so many areas of the world try these different economic systems and fail miserably, and people suffer needlessly because of it. So, yeah, do we have, technically a pure capitalist system? No, it's a blend. But for the most part, it works really, really well. But yeah, it's all about value. It's all about the value proposition. And for sure, it is something that most people who live in the United States are comfortable with, just living day to day with the fact that when they buy something, they're getting value. When they sell something, there's value for the person. And there's value along the chain, right? When we're buying a piece of land from a seller, we're helping them get rid of an asset that's now become a liability for them. When we sell that property to someone else, that person that's bought it is now paying property taxes. Those property taxes go and help those communities and allow those communities to build schools and hospitals and improve their roads. And then finally, you as the person for creating the machine, for creating the business, you get rewarded as well. What you do with that reward can be extremely moral and extremely ethical, because the more you make, the more opportunities you have to give. And that in and of itself could be the best argument for capitalism. Make as much money as you can so you can give and improve others' lives as much as you can before your time on earth is done. Teria, what do you think?
I like that a lot.
Landon C., what do you think?
Uh-oh. Violation.
You just violated the rule. That's a $5,000 fine per the rule, Mark.
It's everybody in the room.
By the way, lucky for me, I can violate it and spend that $5,000 to the charity of my choice, which is going to be balltoall.org.
It doesn't say that it has to be a contribution. No, I think it says, well, we will have to vote to make sure we clarify the wording there. Who you have to pay that to. It's the charity. Or 6 months in prison, jail.
Yeah, there's a reason people don't like lawyers. And we're starting to see this in real time.
Listen, I didn't do this. I didn't make the rule up. It exists. Right. I found it. I did a search.
Well, if you're still listening to this, we still have more value to transmit to you, dear listener, because we're going to go to a land shark and ask him for his tip of the week, a website, a resource, a book, something else actionable for the Art of Passive Income listeners to go improve their businesses, improve their lives, surf and turf. What's your thought?
I guess I answered anything at this point. So my tip of the week is Appley. It's appley.com. I'll put it in the chat. It's basically a tracker, time tracker. You can use it for your VAs, track their time, see, you know, how much time they're putting in and be able to like know how much you need to pay them. But it also has a lot of other tools that you can use, like scheduling and client invoicing, task management, payroll, you name it. It's got a ton. It's something that came across and I was like, yeah, this is great for managing some of your VAs. Now, disclaimer, if you're on Upwork, if you're on Fiverr, you should pay through them because I'm a rule follower. That's what I do because I'm morally straight and centered. That's what I do. But so that's my disclaimer for that. But other than that, that's my
okay. Okay, put it in the chat. I want to check this right. Tip out, this site out for sure. Erik Peterson, have you heard of this Appley?
I have not.
I'm number one at- time tracker app and software. Time track for desk, mobile, and time tracking for desk, mobile, and remote teams. Track time and increase your team's productivity for up to 20%.
I think they want it to be called like employee, like employee.
Oh, employee. I like it.
I thought it was Appley.
It's pretty cheap. $10
per month. If you do it for a year, it's like $2 to $3. It's pretty cheap. It's affordable.
Are you using it?
I was going to plug one of our VAs into it this week. So yeah, it just intrigued me. And I was like, I think I'm going to start using this to kind of plug some of the VAs in. Cause we do have some that aren't from Upwork or Fiverr and I kind of want to track what they're doing. I want to know. So let's keep them a little honest.
You know what though? I don't know. If you have to track someone's honesty, maybe they're not the right person to be working with.
These guys are making $3 an hour. So you got to, you know, it's not above them to try to get a little bit more. I want to know. I really want to be able to figure that out. Because we do. We go in and we'll track and look at our VAs and go, it doesn't take you that long to do this job. We've done it in 5 minutes. So I feel like I can kind of research a little bit with this.
All right. I mean, it's going to be an uncomfortable conversation with your VA. Like, by the way, we're going to track you. We're going to take screenshots of your desktop as well so we can see what you're doing. We're going to track your usage on certain apps. We're going to track your URLs. We're just going to watch you work.
But if you're Upwork, they do the same thing. They do the exact same thing. They track.
They track.
Oh yeah. Yeah. We've caught one of ours playing video games because they track
on company time.
on company time.
I'm not paying for that. I'm paying for it.
All right.
Yeah.
Scott Todd, what do you think?
I don't know. I kind of use, okay, like if I had someone indirect, maybe most time I do because I follow the rules, you know, like Upwork, and I don't really have anybody that I would pay. I mean, I guess there's people that I do pay by the hour technically, but I don't track them. I don't know. Maybe I should. Maybe I should. I don't know. I don't really want to, as long as they're doing their job, like, I don't know. See, the way I look at it is this. Let's pick on due diligence, for example. So I know it takes me, like, I can do a pretty good job of due diligence in about 40 minutes. And maybe a little bit slower since I haven't done it in a while, but I could probably do a due diligence on a property in about 40 minutes. I have a VA that's just slow. Okay. He makes $8 an hour and he just bills me for 2 hours for the due diligence per property. Okay. So I'm paying him basically $16 to do due diligence on a property. And, you know, when I think about, I do it for 40 minutes. He should be doing it for 40 minutes. I'm thinking like, okay, it cost me an extra $8 not to have to worry about it. And then beyond that, like I've never found a problem with this due diligence. And then beyond that, is my time really worth kind of like tracking that down? So I don't know.
I mean, getting back to the, you know, to take this full circle, is it moral and ethical to watch somebody work in that way? For example, if we golden ruled it, Landon, would you want someone in your house sitting with you watching you work?
So our business is it's a little different, right? It's not the usual, it's not the norm. But let's say you have a 9-to-5 or you're an hourly employee. You clock in and you clock out. Now, you have managers that are around and you have supervisors, and they're all either watching what you're doing if they're good supervisors or managers. So they're kind of watching how you're working. And if you're not doing the job, you get fired or you get written up, whatever. I don't know. Like for me, I think that's a really fair point.
I actually do think that's a great point. I think we're going to give Teria the last word on this.
When we were talking about the app, because we have had a couple of employees that were outside of Upwork, they were hourly, and we did have questions like, okay, it should not take you 4 hours to remake pictures, right? It just shouldn't take you that long to do. And we've gotten you be funky and you can upload a whole. So what exactly are you doing? So even if it's not a constant, I'm going to monitor you, big brother, you know, for weeks at a time, at the very least, let us see what you're doing so we can help improve whatever process you think you're doing. But give us this time so we can see exactly what you're doing. Justify for us the amount of time it's taking you.
Fair enough. I think it's a legitimately solid tip of the week from Landon C. So Tate just jumped on. I love it when you call me Big Papa. Tate, we've been having
Mark's at $10,000.
We've been having an issue
so far today.
All right, the 20,000.
What?
The community has spoken.
Mark owes us $10,000. That's what I'm saying.
Glad I got on this podcast.
Okay, the community has
a modern swear jar.
Swear jar.
The community has spoken. They like Landshark as Landon's nickname.
They did not speak.
And you are not the community.
It was on Mighty Networks. Solely.
It is not on Mighty Networks, Mark. No. Gretchen asked a question. There's no poll. I found no poll to this. And where is this poll?
Anyway,
I swear I saw something.
Do you like? Aquatic investor Landon AI. That's a big mouthful right there. Landon AI.
That's all you gotta say.
Landon AI, which doesn't have that much personality, number one. Or Landon C, which I find very clever because it's like Landon C. And then Land Shark. I think those are the, I mean, Surf and Turf, I don't like at all.
I definitely do not like Surf and Turf. that one that you said that was like a paragraph in length, I'm out on that one. I can't remember what that was, but it was really long. I really like Landon. Like that, I think that's just a solid name. Like, hey, Landon.
It is, and it's
I'm not
Landon.
Really a fan of like
no creativity like, to that.
I'm just like, hey, Landon. What's wrong with that? Like, it's dark. I think we're missing the boat here. Like, the guy has got the word land in his given name. I don't know. I mean,
but he's a professional swim coach. Landon C, I think, could be the winner.
Listen,
yeah, but
Mark, I just gave
he's
you the
Landon
in the
mind land investor.
There's no pull, nothing, not a pull at all. Okay. It's you weighing in saying that you like the land shark, but you don't love it. One person, Ryan Perez said Landon C. Okay. Teria, she wins. She wins the default. Aquatic investor AI. That's
why are you giving Teria the final word on this?
Listen,
Teria doesn't make
do
up.
You know Teria? Look at her, man. You're gonna see her in boot camp soon. Don't mess with Teria.
I'm not saying I'm messing with Teria. I'm just saying.
Yeah, I changed my vote.
She lives with Landon.
Hey, can you see the chat? Can you see the chat?
No. I just see the link you posted.
Here, I'll put.
I got it right here. Look, Tate. We found this. I found this today.
Oh, Teria Harris. I like Scott Todd's suggestion. AI, aquatic investor. He's too close to it. Too close.
I put that before the call. I didn't realize it was going to be the topic. That was early today.
Oh, okay.
Hey, did you see that rule I found? And Mark says he's a rule follower. He said he claimed on this podcast he's a rule follower. If the sign says, he said, if the sign says, don't walk, don't walk. And I gave him a sign that says this.
Right. Well, hey, look, fair is fair. And the one thing that this rule doesn't say is it fines up to $5,000 per person that was offended, or is it just a lump sum, Scott? Do you know? Because I'm offended.
Yeah, okay, I think so every person on the call gets it.
So what it said, what the rule says is
Tate wants his payday.
Whoever violates this, okay, whoever does not properly identify Landon as Landon AI may result in fines up to $5,000 and or 6 months in jail, okay, and also for damages. So Mark has already violated this rule twice at a minimum. Okay, maybe pushing a third time.
We should probably just round up.
The jury says three.
We should.
And as a result of that, he's found guilty. He's found guilty. He now owes us $15,000.
By the way, for all the lawyers who are listening to this, feel free to DM me in Mighty Networks. And I've got some pro bono work for you. For sure. So, anyway.
Yeah, I mean... it is what it is. Excuse me, Landon AI. I was not aware of this rule when I jumped on this call, but, you know, Teria has spoken. So has the internet, apparently. And there's binding law.
Binding.
I think at the next boot camp, which will be like by the time this is recorded, like goes off, it'll be done with it. So the virtual boot camp this weekend, that will be the final say. We'll do a poll. And that'll be it.
Fair enough. I still vote with Teria.
And then, of course, Teria will have the final say.
Whatever the community says, we'll go. We'll go with it.
All right. Fair enough. Well, I thought this was a lively debate, a great topic. And I want to thank you, dear listener. So if you're getting value, please support us. Follow, rate, review the podcast. Send us a screenshot of that review, support@thelandgeek.com. I'm going to send you for free a signed copy of Dirt Rich, and I might even sign it. Mark, parentheses, AI. There you go. Just to make Scott Todd happy. I don't know. All right. Are we all good?
All good.
All right. Are we ready to do this?
Yes.
One, two, three. Let
freedom ring.
Land and Sea, I thought that was a great podcast.
It's fun.
That rolls off the tongue.
It just rolls.
$20,000 we're up to now, guys.
What rolls off the tongue?
Land and Sea.
Five. We all agree. Racking this is the most field. Profitable podcast we've ever been on.
Tate, seriously, say Land and Sea and then say Land and AI.
Land and AI.
Eric?
God, I'm not trying to owe any money here.
No, you gotta say them both.
I'll say it off air.
Oh my gosh. I feel this, yeah.
Land and AI.
Okay, Mark. Here.
I used to play this game with my kids, by the way. We'd pick a word and then you try to get them to say the word. Oh no, the word was what? So then you would just like you play the game, like, can you get them to say what? And I'd be like, how's it remember that? Like what? Like, hear it.
Mark, here is the proper poll question. Here it is.
Okay. Which name best represents Landon's innovative and forward-thinking approach? Landon AI or Landon C?
Landon C.
Are you referring to like C as in the SEA?
But which name best represents, besides his innovative and forward-thinking approach?
Oh no, that's the poll question.
His personality.
No, that's the poll question. The internet has spoken. That's the appropriate question.
Do you know how much time this guy has spent in water?
A lot of time.
I think that needs to be reflected in the nickname.
Investor. We got that.
Aquatic is too long. It doesn't roll off the tongue. The technician. I love it when you call me Big Papa, which
kind of long.
It's kind of long.
Really long, Mark. And it might roll off the tongue, but it's really, really long.
Yeah, but it also represents the love of rap. And Biggie Smalls.
Some of the older audience don't understand what it even means. They're like, I don't know what that means. He must be a dad.
Yeah. By the way, we have another topic just Tate and I need to discuss. Is it politically incorrect now to still listen to Kanye?
Yes.
Can we still listen to Kanye? Can we still enjoy his music?
No,
you can't. Because we're talking about morals and ethics. I mean, look, I think it's okay. Now, this is my argument. I can separate the human being because we're all flawed. From the art, because if I look back in history at all the great artists, I'm sure as human beings, they weren't that great because they're all flawed anyways.
Yeah, I mean it's kind of like the art, hate the artist. I think that's a pretty common question that a lot of people have struggled with. But everybody who's listening to this is a big boy or big girl. They can make their own decisions as to whether or not they want to listen to something. As long as it's this podcast, you can listen to it. Anything else, that's up for you to decide.
100%. But if you're at a party and you're with mixed company, do you bring it up? Or is this just something like, I mean, do you have to be a closet Kanye listener now? If I'm listening to Graduation, can I not be like, oh, what are you listening to? I'm like,
Bach.
you just say, I listened to Kanye before I knew he was crazy.
Yeah. I don't know, man.
That's fair. Well, we'll see how his next album goes.
That'll be interesting.
Yeah. I don't know why I even brought that up, but morals and ethics. Anyways. We're off topic. Thanks, everybody.
See ya.
Bye.
Yeah.
Thanks for listening to the Art of Passive Income podcast. Are you ready to learn how you can start building a passive income without renters, rehabs, renovations, or rodents? Schedule a free consultation at thelandgeek.com/training. Let freedom ring.